Thousands of miles from the busy streets of Dhaka in Bangladesh, there's a glitzy casino called the Solaire. It sits on the waterfront in Manila, capital of the Philippines.
I've been there. I've visited to research this story, and it's an amazing location. It's a big white stucco building surrounded by the flat docklands. It looks like a giant tooth sticking up from the ground. And back in 2016, the week after computer hackers set out to steal $1 billion from Bangladesh Bank, Robbie Lin is in the middle of his shift in one of the VIP rooms on the first floor of that building. Robbie is a VIP host, and it's his job to look after the casino's richest customers.
And the last few days have been absolutely crazy. It was the Lunar New Year, Asia's biggest holiday, and the busiest time of the year for the casino. Just as things look like they're getting back to normal,
half a dozen guys speaking Chinese walk into Robbie's VIP area, but there's something odd about them.
Their appearance just really ordinary. The way they dressed didn't make them seem genuine. They just didn't look like people who had lots of money.
Not like the kind of people Robbie's used to serving, with their fancy cars and designer clothes. Robbie says that once, a client pitched up with a deposit of 200 million Philippines pesos. That's $10 million.
And as you can imagine, when you're playing with that kind of money, you expect top service.
The VIP room is like a luxurious house. There is a lounge area, a dining table, a mini bar with food and beverages on demand. They have their own bathroom, so everything feels really special.
You get the privacy, you get the service, you get the personalized attention that you feel you deserve. You know, I want a bottle of Hennessy XO, and you'll get it.
Mohammed Cohen is a casino expert and editor-at-large of Inside Asian Gaming magazine. He knows how tough it is to be at the beck and call of these kind of high rollers.
I want a mani-pedi for my wife, and I want somebody to take her shopping. Take her to see the sights in Manila, please, so she's not bored while I'm doing this. And make me my favorite dish when I'm hungry.
But how much would you have to be gambling to get these perks?
Somebody comes for a weekend and is depositing, let's say, $250,000 US, you know, they'd be in the top class.
But that's the thing. Robbie can't help feeling that the Chinese guys who just walked into his VIP area don't look top class. Turns out, though, his first impression is wrong. Apparently, these chaps are absolutely loaded.
Suddenly, the money they are here to gamble appears, and it took them a while to count it all. There were stacks and stacks of cash high like a mountain. And as the host, I'm only thinking, wow, this group is very rich, brilliant.
He's impressed, but at the same time, the money doesn't seem right to Robbie, because these men aren't regulars.
Our VIP guests are usually high-profile people, so we would know their background. But who are these people? How come they have so much money? Until now, we've never heard of them.
But it's when the men start playing that Robbie and his colleagues notice some really strange things.
Almost every day, they followed the same routine. They would play from 8 in the morning until 11:30, then stop at lunchtime, take their chips back to their hotel room. And the following day, the same thing. They came back, sat down, and played from 8 until 11:30.
It's like they're treating gambling like a regular day job.
So I assumed that these people must have a boss, because they were following such a strict routine.
But the thing that stands out to Robbie the most is the men's reactions to the games they're playing. These guys just don't seem to care if they win or lose.
People who gamble are usually quite tense, and when they lose, they look heartbroken, and when they win, delirious. These people didn't seem to have any reaction either way. No enthusiasm. They're just acting as if nothing had happened.
There's a good reason these men are behaving so strangely. They're hiding a secret. It's not their own money they're gambling. It's money that's been stolen from the Bangladesh Bank.
They're part of the plot to spirit away the bank's money. It's not like the movies. There are no fast cars, no screaming tires, no pumping soundtrack. But the process of escaping with the money is going to be every bit as tense as in the films. And like a good getaway driver, the criminals who raided the bank will need careful planning, nerves of steel, and razor-sharp timing to make it all work.
The heist on the bank has moved to its next phase, the getaway.
And if these men and their accomplices play their cards right, quite literally, they can make sure that Bangladesh will never see that money ever again.
From the BBC World Service, this is The Lazarus Heist.
I'm Geoff White.
I'm Jean Lee.
Episode 7, Korean Roulette. The raid on Bangladesh Bank started in January 2015, when investigators say North Korea's Lazarus Group hackers first got access to the bank's computer systems. But they didn't actually steal the money until a year later. What were they up to during those 12 months? Quite a lot, it turns out.
In May 2015, four accounts are set up at a branch of a Philippines bank called RCBC. The bank is on Jupiter Street in the capital, Manila.
After the four accounts get created, well, nothing happens. They just sit dormant for month after month with their initial deposit of $500 untouched.
And then suddenly, on Monday, February 8th, 2016, immediately after the cyber raid on the Bangladesh bank, those account holders become overnight millionaires.
Michael Cruz gets $6 million.
Jesse La Grossa, $30
million. Alfred Vergara gets almost $20 million.
Enrico Vasquez, $25 million. In total, the Lazarus Group hackers transferred $81 million from Bangladesh Bank's accounts to these four people.
So, are the account holders rushing to withdraw the money? Are they gleefully planning how to spend their millions? No. Because they don't exist.
The account holders were found to have fake addresses. The account holders' identification documents, for example, the driver's license cards, were found to be fake.
That's Senator Teofisto Gingona. He's the chair of the Philippine Senate investigation that was set up to unravel what happened to Bangladesh Bank's money once it reached Manila. And he's got quite a job on his hands. The fake accounts are just the start of it. As his committee digs, they find out that the bank branch on Jupiter Street is hiding a lot of very worrying secrets.
When I went to Manila, I paid a visit to Jupiter Street because I wanted to see the RCBC bank to which the hackers transferred their stolen millions. I wasn't sure what to expect. In the end, what I found was just a single unit sandwiched between an eco-hotel and a dentist surgery. Standing at the door was something you see a lot at financial institutions in Manila. A bored-looking security guard brandishing a frighteningly large pump-action shotgun. And for me, that summed up the whole thing. This bank was ready for a physical attack via the front door. What they're less prepared for, it seems, was a massive crime happening digitally via the back office.
As the Philippine Senate Committee is about to discover, this little bank branch is going to play a vital role in the heist on the Bangladesh bank.
When the stolen $81 million arrives that week in February 2016, it kicks off a flurry of activity at the RCBC branch. First, the $81 million starts being moved around between different accounts.
$22,735,000 transferred from Jesse Lagrosis to account number
901645520. $40,200,000 from account number 901645520.
$23,725,000 transferred to account number.
Some of the money gets sent to an exchange where it's swapped into the local currency, pesos, and then redeposited back into other accounts at the RCBC branch.
The Senate committee hears testimony from a bank employee who tells a remarkable story. As he appears in the committee chamber, Reserve Officer Romaldo Agarado seems terrified about the prospect of giving his evidence, which he does in a mix of English and Filipino language.
For the teller, na doon na dapat siya magkuhan, what do you call that?
Take your time. I know you're a bit tense, but it's all right.
Romaldo then goes on to give an account of what he sees after the money arrives at the bank. As you may remember, it's a long weekend in the Philippines, a holiday across Asia for Lunar New Year. But according to Romaldo, the RCBC branch on Jupiter Street is buzzing with activity that Monday.
It was packed per plastic po, coming, naka-pack na po siya. So
What Romaldo says he witnessed doesn't look like anything I've seen in my local bank branch. He says some of the money transferred to the accounts, about $400,000, is put into a cardboard box and loaded into the bank manager's own car.
Her car at that time was just parked outside the branch.
Does your CCTV provide for that?
That's a good question from one of the committee members, Senator Vicente Soto. What about the bank's surveillance cameras? Surely they would have captured all of that.
Unfortunately, po, Your Honor,
that was the time that CCTV is not working. All right.
That's right. The bank's surveillance cameras are out of action for the entire time when all this is going on. Another sign that whoever plotted this part of the heist have put a lot of planning into it and may even have been able to access the bank's surveillance systems. What about the bank's manager?
The branch manager is Miss Maya.
The branch manager is Miss Maya Digito.
So she was your boss?
Yes, she was.
So what was Romaldo's bank manager, Maya Digito, thinking while all of this was happening, while millions of dollars were flying digitally around the bank, some of it being loaded into her own car?
Romaldo says he asked her about all the suspicious transfers of money, and the response he gets is chilling.
I would rather do this than me being killed or my family.
Death threats, broken CCTV, cash in cardboard boxes, multi-million dollar transfers. The arrival of the stolen Bangladesh money has triggered some deeply suspicious activity. And the one key person who might be able to explain it all for us is the branch manager.
We spoke to her lawyer, Ferdinand Tapascio. He denies that Maya received death threats, but he admits she was terrified when she first came to him for help in the weeks after the money washed through her bank branch. He says RCBC had started an internal investigation and Maya was
frightened. She was distraught. She knew that she would lose her job.
The committee's hearings had thrown up some serious concerns about what happened in her branch. So my first question was an obvious one.
Wasn't that a bit suspicious that money arrives in the branch, is loaded into boxes and loaded into cars and taken out? That doesn't seem very usual.
Well, you have to understand the culture of banking here. In cases of what they would call valued clients, the bank managers go over and above the call of duty to please them, with an eye always to the average daily balance.
Well, in this case, she went over and above the call of duty to take part in a fraud, sounds like.
Well, ultimately, what happened was a fraud, but I'm not saying that my client is blameless. It is just that she was a victim of a confluence of events that made it appear that she was the only one here. She may have been negligent, she may have been too trusting, but something of this magnitude could not have been accomplished by a mere bank manager. Here in this country, the law is like a spider web. Only the small get caught. The big ones go right through.
This was Maya Digito's argument the whole way along. And this is also what she told the Senate hearing in a statement.
I am but a pawn in a high-stakes chess game played by giants in international banking and high finance. If this committee is looking for the grandmaster, it is not me. On hindsight, I have unwittingly allowed myself to be set up as the scapegoat when all I wanted was to advance my career and together with my husband help provide for my family.
That broken CCTV? Maya says she'd reported it to her bosses and it wasn't her job to fix it. The fake IDs used to set up the accounts that received the stolen money? Maya says it wasn't her job to check them. That was for head office to do. She seemed to have an answer for everything, but I still had questions for her lawyer.
So you've got a situation where the accounts are opened up. Maya Digito says she met the people, got their IDs and so on. Then suddenly there's a lot of money, a huge amount of money washing into these accounts. Maya Digito is obviously concerned about that, but told to keep going. The CCTV is out of action. If I was the bank manager, I'd call the police. Why didn't she?
Well, she saw nothing wrong with the transaction after she was given the green light by head office. Oh, that is the long and short of it. Had she not been given any go signal or had the head office gone silent, I'm sure she would have taken other measures to ensure the monies would have been protected.
I gather Maya Digito says that she was told, let this money through.
Yes, we have the emails to prove it.
Maya Digito herself is not available for interview because she's been convicted in connection with the heist. She's appealing against it, but as it stands, she's been sentenced to 56 years in prison and fined $109 million. That's more, of course, than the $81 million she's accused of having helped launder. We approached RCBC headquarters for a response to Maya DeGuito and her lawyer's allegations, but they haven't got back to us. In a previous statement to the media, RCBC said that DeGuito's conviction showed that it was the victim and that the ex-manager was a rogue employee. The hackers may have taken many millions out of Bangladesh Bank's accounts, but they aren't out of the woods yet. They know that investigators will now be on their tail and will be trying to trace the money through the various banks' computer systems. And if it can be traced, it can potentially be clawed back by the bank.
Ultimately, Maya DeGuito's RCBC bank branch had been used to perform a basic but vital role in the heist. The idea was to move the money around rapidly in order to throw investigators off the scent. It's classic money laundering.
And it doesn't stop at the bank. The criminals are going to go much, much further. They'll end up in the glamorous world of Manila's casino scene. And this is where North Korea's international network would come in very handy indeed. We're on the trail of the $81 million stolen from the Bank of Bangladesh. But stealing it was, in a way, the easy part.
The money laundering piece is the most challenging piece for criminals. Turning all of that criminal revenue into clean cash that they can then use, that is very challenging.
Moyara Ruzin is the director of the Financial Crime Management Program at the Middlebury Institute of International Studies in Monterey, California.
She's an economist by training, and in the early 2000s, she realized that, apart from bankers and lawyers, not many people were investigating money laundering, she says. And so after 9/11, she became one of the first academics to study how terrorism was financed.
And then have since gone into the financing of weapons of mass destruction programs, in particular, what North Korea has been doing.
So basically what happened was this. Moyara did a video for Vanity Fair talking about money laundering in Hollywood movies and how that would work in real life. And I just thought the video was great. So when I was looking for someone to explain how the North Korean regime might go about money laundering, claims they strongly deny, of course, I went to Moyara.
I guess the question would be, why is it necessary for criminals to launder money? I mean, if I've stolen $1 million, what's stopping me just going out and spending it and having a good time, I guess?
Yes, exactly. So even if I raised a lot of money from, you know, cybercrime or drug trafficking, and then use that money to buy a house, if investigators can tie the purchase of that house to the original criminally derived funds, they can seize my house. So you have to really disguise the connection there in order to protect whatever you do with the money afterwards.
Key to the process, she says, is putting as many obstacles as you can in the way of the people trying to trace the loot.
You want to make the money trail as muddy and obscure as possible.
By the way, we're not revealing any big secrets here. What Moyara is about to explain are the general principles, and they're well known. As in, they're on the internet. And besides, knowing the principles is a far cry from being able to actually apply them.
Can you talk me through the sort of classic stages that one would go through in a money laundering operation?
The first stage, of course, is placing that dirty cash into the financial system. And that is probably the most challenging stage for a criminal, because that is the stage at which investigators are most likely to red flag the suspicious activity.
The Lazarus Group hackers who broke into the Bangladesh Bank know all about those red flags because they'd already fallen foul of them. So their original plan had been to steal $951 million by transferring them out of the Bangladeshi account at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York.
But the Fed had spotted the transfers because the hackers had sent the money to the bank in Jupiter Street. Jupiter just happened to be the name of an Iranian ship that was on a sanctions list, so the Fed stopped many of the transfers.
But before the Fed hit the brakes, $100 million got through, $81 million of which had been transferred to that bank in Manila. So from now on, the hackers don't want any more red flags. They want to make sure that the money passes smoothly through the financial system. Now, they can start extracting it from the bank and take it to the next stage of the laundering process.
After the money's washed around in the RCBC bank, a chunk of the $81 million is pulled out in local currency, pesos. And we're talking like lots of pesos.
The average is that 1 million pesos is equals about a kilo of bills. So half a billion pesos is about 500 kilos.
Rodolfo Kimbo, he's director of the Philippine Senate Committee that investigated the heist, and he is talking about half a ton of cash. That's the weight of a grand piano.
It was picked up by two Chinese men with assistants who would be loading the money into their cars. So how do you load 500 kilos into a car that swiftly? Which means that they had to have trucks, they had to have people who would carry those bills, because 500 kilos is not necessarily capable of being carried by a single person. This was a big operation.
Rodolfo's Senate committee then manages to uncover the fact that this cash, adding up to around $30 million, gets paid over to a Chinese man called Wei Kang Zhu. So now he's sitting on a big chunk of the $81 million stolen from Bangladesh Bank. Great, perhaps this Wei Kang Zhu guy can shed some light on all this.
Unfortunately, no. When the committee chairman asks about him, he gets this response from the Philippines Anti-Money Laundering Authority.
We received information that this Mr. Wei Kang Zhu probably has left the country via a private plane, Your Honor.
I suppose if it's a private plane, you still have to go through immigration. But what did immigration say?
They don't have a record of his departure, Your Honor.
So of the $81 million, our mystery man, Wei Kang Zhu, walks off with $30 million. Some speculate it was his payment for organizing the operation, though the Philippines authorities say there wasn't enough evidence for prosecution. So after Xu's departure, there's now $51 million left in the Philippines.
Surely the crooks have done enough by now to move that money beyond the grasp of investigators. Well, actually no. The people pursuing them can still just about trace it. So what the crooks now need is a rock-solid way of making sure the investigators can never get it back, ever.
Time for the next stage in the money laundering process, layering.
The layering stage is the exciting part of money laundering. What we as investigators study, it's what I teach my students in my program.
Moyara says it's all about transforming the money so it can't be tracked.
There are a number of things that you can change. So you can move it from dollars into cryptocurrency or dollars into British pounds or gold or some other type of asset. You can move it into real estate or of stocks and then sell those real estate and stocks.
Forget real estate and stocks. In the Bangladesh bank case, the criminals had a much more exciting option for layering that stolen money.
When I was in Manila, after visiting the RCBC bank branch, I took a trip to the Solaire Casino. It's a beautiful location overlooking the waterfront. It's also, as a side point, the only place in the world I've ever been offered a bag stool. I went for a drink in the bar, and the waiter offered me a little chair that my bag could sit on. And I had no idea these things existed, but I guess if you just bought a Louis Vuitton handbag, you don't want to put that on the floor. Although my rucksack looked a bit weird sitting on a chair. This was the place, though, where Robbie was working back in 2016 when those half dozen Chinese gamblers arrived. As you probably figured out by now, the millions of dollars they brought with them in piles was part of the money stolen from Bangladesh Bank.
After washing the money through the RCBC bank branch and giving Wei Kang Zhu his $30 million, there's $51 million left. And it gets split between two casinos. About $30 million is transferred to accounts at the Solaire, and about $20 million to a smaller one across town called, guess what, the Midas. The gamblers in Robbie's VIP room at the Solaire aren't the only group using this money. Across Manila, there are several teams hitting the two casinos with the stolen cash, but they aren't just there to enjoy the bag stools and the free drinks.
Clearly, the criminals had a plan for how to utilize the casinos. This was another part of the money laundering scheme, right? But why on earth would you go to a casino to launder money? Moyara Rusin's got the answer for us.
Imagine that I am a criminal with a lot of dirty cash. I turn that money into chips, into casino chips. I gamble a little bit, try not to lose much money. And then when I'm done gambling, I turn all of those chips back into a casino check. So now it looks like my winnings at a casino. And then I'm out the door, I deposit my winnings somewhere and nobody asks any questions.
I don't know whether you noticed this, but part of Mayara's instructions there was try not to lose much money. Maybe it's just me, but that's not something I've ever managed to achieve on the few occasions I've been into a casino. Clearly, I'm not a very good gambler.
But even if the criminals laundering Bangladesh Bank's money are much better gamblers, aren't they still taking a big risk by laundering their money by betting it in a casino? How can they be sure they're not going to lose masses of it?
Imagine you and I walk into a casino. We've each got $100, and we want to lose as little as possible. So we change our cash into chips and we go to the big spinning roulette wheel. I bet my $100 of chips that it'll land on a red number. You bet your $100 it'll land on black. Black it is. I lose my $100, boo-hoo. But you win $100, so now you've got $200 of chips. And since we're such good buddies, you give me half, we both go and change our chips back into cash, and we walk out with $100 each, just like at the start. There's a slim chance, of course, that the roulette ball will land on green. That's the casino's colour. And in that case, we both lose. But there's only ever one or two green squares on the wheel, depending on where you play, so that's a pretty low chance. Most of the time, it's going to either land on red or black, and we can make our little system work. But this whole system only works if we place polar opposites of each other's bets, right? So we'll almost always break out even, but neither one of us will ever really profit. That's not very satisfying for a gambling trip.
But remember, in the Bangladesh bank heist, the people who take the money to the casino aren't going there to win any bets. They are playing a different game. They're going there to launder the money. So for them, breaking even is absolutely fine. And that's why the men in Robbie's VIP room are so relaxed. If one of them loses, he knows that one of his accomplices will win, and vice versa. They're not concerned about making money from the games because they're being paid by the money launderers to wash their chips through the system. But hold on, Geoff. Why do they have to gamble at all? Why not just change the money into chips, walk around for a little bit, maybe get a drink, and then change it back into cash and walk out?
That's a very good question. Firstly, doing that with $30 million would raise a lot of alarm bells. It's hard to go unnoticed doing that. Also, to get this much money into the casino and to make it all look above board, the money launderers had to organise what are called junkets. These are private, invite-only gambling sessions held in VIP rooms like the one Robbie worked in. Now, to play in those junket rooms, you're given special chips. They're called room chips, and they can only be gambled and used in that room. You can't take those chips and simply exchange them for a check and walk out. But as you gamble those chips, the chips you win back are normal casino chips, and those ones can be taken to the counter, swapped for cash, and moved out the casino.
So the money launderers have to go through the motions of gambling. They have to sit there day after day splashing the cash, and they probably know that at any moment they might get caught by investigators on their tail.
Yeah, and they've got another challenge, finding the right game to play.
Baccarat is a favorite game among Chinese gamblers. There's no skill involved, it's all pure luck. But other people feel like this is a contest between them and fate, and they want to see if they can triumph over fate.
Mohammed Cohen's the casino expert you heard at the beginning of the episode. Baccarat started off in Europe. It was actually James Bond's favourite, according to the books, and it's now the world's biggest gambling game.
It's basically Baccarat's a card game where there are two hands, a banker hand and a player hand. The objective is to get as close to nine as possible without going over. Let's say you get a 3 and an 8, that's 11. You take off the front digit, so that's a 1. And so again, the only thing you do is decide whether you're gonna bet on the player hand or whether you're gonna bet on the banker hand.
You know, you have, in this case, tens of millions of dollars in chips that are bought with money that was stolen from the Bangladesh Central Bank. You then play at these casinos, and you don't really want to win or lose. What you want to do is be even. And with Baccarat, then you can actually do so because you can bet both sides of the hand.
This is investigative journalist Alan Katz, editor for Financial Investigations for Europe for Bloomberg News. He investigated the casino aspect of this heist very closely.
He says Baccarat's the right game to play because it's similar to the roulette wheel. There's only two outcomes to bet on, so the money launderers can balance their bets against each other.
Whatever money you win are generally casino chips. And those chips you can then go to the cash counter and transfer them into cash. And so if you play for long enough, in this case they played for weeks, you can take the money out of the casino, now it's laundered.
So these guys were playing baccarat literally for weeks. What was Bangladesh Bank doing all this time? Why couldn't they stop all this?
So the bank discovers the theft within 2 days of the money going missing. And at first, they assume that getting it back might be a simple process of reversing the funds. But they're wrong. Thanks to the criminals' planning, clawing back that money is proving to be a nightmare. And the Bangladeshi government is now pulling in the big guns to help.
My name is Ajmal Hussain. I am a barrister, a Queen's Counsel in England. I am a senior advocate in Bangladesh, which is the equivalent of a Queen's Counsel in that jurisdiction. So I'm a practicing lawyer in two jurisdictions.
If you're not sure what a Queen's Counsel is, basically it's a top-end lawyer, usually very expensive. Ajmal is hired by the Bangladesh government to help trace the money. He starts to run into problems almost immediately.
It was quite amazing. The first several weeks, it was a complete denial by everyone about third-party hackers being involved, including the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, the SWIFT. They were all treating this as genuine transactions. So they need to be persuaded about that.
When it becomes clear the money has ended up in the Philippines, Ajmalul makes repeated trips to the country.
I personally went, 6 or 7 times, but the banking officials went many more times.
But they get short shrift there too.
They were making assertions that the people in the Bangladesh Central Bank who were involved and saying, well, this was all your problem. Really, they were not engaging on the fact that this was stolen money.
Soon after discovering the theft, Bangladesh Bank had sent stop orders to RCBC, the bank in the Philippines, telling them to hold the funds. But it took time for RCBC to process those requests. And by the time they did, the money was already out the door and had been transferred to the casinos.
So of course, the Bangladeshis then pursued the money into the casinos. And they had a bit of luck. They managed to get back $16 million from a guy called Kim Wong. He was one of the men who organized the private gambling sessions, the junkets, at the Midas Casino. And he also helped the bank manager, Maya DeGuito, set up the accounts at RCBC. It's a bit like a game of pass the parcel. When the music stopped, Kim Wong was left holding some of the money, so he handed it back. He was initially charged in the Philippines, but those charges were later dropped. But as for the rest of the money, Bangladesh Bank hit a stone wall there because, as Moyaro explains...
The Philippines at the time did not have any types of anti-money laundering regulations for their casinos. That's highly unusual. Most casinos around the world do have to follow anti-money laundering protocols. Because in the past, you know, decades ago, we know that organized crime used casinos to launder money. It's such a convenient way to launder your funds. Here's where the North Koreans were very smart in selecting their target countries for where they were going to move the money.
This has all changed now. The Philippines casinos are covered by money laundering rules. But back in 2016, the lack of regulation means that when Bangladesh Bank officials approach the casinos, they aren't able to help. As far as the casinos are concerned, the people who turned up with the stolen millions are genuine customers and they've got a right to gamble the money.
The Salar Casino says they had no idea they were dealing with stolen funds and are cooperating with the authorities. We also approached the Midas Casino for a statement, but they haven't got back to us.
It's a crazy situation. Bangladesh Bank knows where the money is. They've tracked it to the casinos. They can almost see it ebbing away over the tables. But due to Philippines law, they can't stop it.
Alan Katz can't believe it either.
What really surprised us was like, who the hell are these guys who like sat in the casino for weeks, right? So like, I was aware of the story. Everyone was aware of the story. Bloomberg wrote about it. Reuters wrote about it. The New York Times wrote about it. And, you know, obviously Philippine newspapers wrote about this. And these guys just sat there and played and played and played and no one bothered them.
While the headlines were all swirling around them.
Absolutely. And then they left. They disappeared.
Having laundered the stolen money across the gaming tables, the gangs of men who had hit up Manila's casinos are now planning to fade into the background.
But Alan Katz and his colleagues are on their trail. and they end up finding a lot about the shadowy men who helped launder Bangladesh banks' stolen money.
His wife asked one of the policemen, where should I tell the lawyer to call to try to either get him out on bail or, you know, to follow up on this? And the policeman said to her, oh, don't bother calling a lawyer. Didn't actually end very well for them.
But before we get to the fate of Gao and Ding, and don't worry, we will, we need to tie up a loose end. Trust me, it'll be worth it. You may remember that $101 million of Bangladesh Bank's money got transferred out of its New York Federal Reserve account. Now, we've just told you about the $81 million that made its way to the Philippines.
But that still leaves $20 million, arguably a small sum given the $951 million the hackers were originally aiming for. Almost all of it intended to be laundered through the Philippines. And yet, the hackers organized a whole separate route to a completely different country just for that $20 million.
And the story gets even weirder when a bank clerk makes a lucky discovery.
A spelling error is about to cost the hackers millions of dollars.
There was one O missing in the foundation. It has come as foundation, F-U-N-D, foundation. That's where they got a message from Bangladesh Bank saying, do not allow this person to withdraw the money.
And it sets Jean and I off on a whole new investigation, one which would expose a completely different side to the Lazarus Group's global operation.
They've never lived in North Korea, but they chose North Korea as their fatherland. So my father's dream was sending their children to North Korea.
That's next time on the Lazarus Heist.
The Lazarus Heist is an original podcast from the BBC World Service. I'm Geoff White.
And I'm Jean Lee. Our producer is Estelle Doyle.
Thanks so much to everyone who's left us ratings and reviews and talked about the show on social media. That really helps us get the word out.
And remember to subscribe as well so that you don't miss any future episodes.
And do also please spread the word on social media. We're using the hashtag Lazarus Heist.
Thank you for listening.